All right, so I've been getting a lot of questions about how Log4j looks on the wire. What does Wireshark see, and how can we analyze it, and better yet, catch it at the packet level? Now, I was finally able to get my hands on some packets. Brad Duncan over at malwaretrafficanalysis.net went ahead and did a capture and gave us permission to go ahead and use this trace file for this video. So I've linked that in the description down below, so you can download that trace file and follow right along with me as I go through it. So Log4j, it's a big vulnerability, and there's a lot of things going on around the internet talking about what it does and how it works. But my goal here for this video is to show you how to catch it on the wire with Wireshark and understand the packets that we're looking at, and to show you some pretty cool stuff that Wireshark shows us about this particular attack. Now, before we get into the weeds, let's remember that this server that we see in this PCAP wasn't necessarily compromised, but this PCAP does show us what was going on with the actual attack. All right, so let's go ahead and take a look at what a Log4j attack looks like at the packet level. Okay, so here I'm in my TCP plain profile, and I have the PCAP in front of me. This is the one that you can open as well. And just to head check yourself, you can look down at the number of packets that you have, and you should have just above 45,000 packets open in Wireshark. Now, just to give us an initial lay of the land, here, this 198.71 box, this was the server that was being attacked. And here we can see there's a lot of different addresses that are coming in and trying to talk to it. And as we can see here on this profile, I have my TCP SYNs lit up green. I like that. And here I can see there's a lot of SYNs coming in. In fact, let's go ahead and map those SYNs and see where they're coming from. If I go up to statistics and I come down to endpoints, here I see I have 4,912 stations, individual stations in this PCAP, so that's quite a bit. But what I want to do is take a look at that country code there. See, I have my country and city. Now I'm going to come down to map, and I'm going to say open in browser. And if I bring that map in, what Wireshark is able to do is take the GeoIP information and throw it on a map of the world for me. Now here I can see I have a lot of different source IPs that are coming into this one server and trying to attack it. So clearly this is a distributed attack. It's coming from a lot of different places, and likely this is all part of a bot army that's just hammering on this server trying to open up several ports. Now, it's possible that these SYNs are related to a different scan that's going on. They aren't necessarily directly related to the Log4j attack. Since we do see them in this PCAP, I wanted to show you how we could put them on a map of the world, and we could see how an attack looks when it's coming from so many different source IPs. But how do I get this to work? Well, basically, we have to enable a GeoIP feature of Wireshark. To do that, I went ahead and linked a video in the description down below to show you how you can enable that with Wireshark. All right, so let's get back to our packets. So a big part about this vulnerability is the JNDI API. Now, that's an API for Java software. It provides naming and directory interface. Now, I'm not going to go too deep in the weeds on what that is and how it's misused, but just for the purposes of our capture, what I want you to do is come up to your display filter, and what we're going to do is we're going to type in IP contains JNDI. What that will do is it'll show us all of the IP packets that we have in this trace file that have those four letters in it. So as we can see, that results in quite a few HTTP gets coming in, as well as a post is the very first one. Now keep in mind that that filter will only work for attacks that happen over port 80 or open web. If it's over 443 or a TLS connection is first set up, then this filter is not going to work because we won't be able to see the clear text. In that case, we would just be relying on the IP and TCP behavior in order to find an attack like this. But for our purposes, since we do have the open HTTP to tinker with, let's go ahead and see what's inside it. Now, if I take a look at that first packet, and I'm going to go ahead and come down here to the details, if I expand HTTP and I come down here, I can see the user agent. That's where that JNDI API information is. So basically what we're saying here is we're calling for LDAP, and here's our IP address and basic command base64. So there's a base64 code over here, and this is what we're going to focus on. So basically, out there, so 45.137.21.9 is sending this post to this server and hoping that it reacts based on what this user agent is saying. So let's go ahead and take a closer look at that user agent. What I want to focus on is this base64 string here. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to right click it, and I want to come down to copy value. So then I'm going to come out to CyberChef, and what I want to do is just toss that in the input. Just going to say paste. And I'm going to clean up my string a little bit here. So I just have those codes. So take out all the way up to base64. Let's go ahead and remove this. I want to take out that last bracket. And what I'm going to do is come over here from base64. So I want to go from base64 and bring that into our output here. So went ahead and said bake, and here we go. So this is the instruction that's being posted to this server. So basically what we're doing is we're saying, hey server, go ahead and do a wget. So go get at this server this shell script and go ahead and give it executable privileges, right? So what is this shell script and who is this guy out here? Let's go ahead and do a bit of a deeper dive here. So here's our IP address. So 62.210.130.250. I'm just gonna copy that guy. And I'm gonna head over to VirusTotal because that has some good information as far as IP addresses or malicious software that's out there. And I'm gonna come over here to search, gonna pop in that IP. And here I can get some community help as far as what is that IP and what is it actually out there doing. So here we can see pretty clearly that this is a malicious IP. Here, Bitdefender, Cyradar, Fortinet, Sophos, all of them are reporting this as malicious. In fact, if I come over here to community, this is where I can see that this IP is related to what several people have seen as far as the Log4j shell vulnerability. And it's being listed on indicators of compromise. So I know that that post coming in from that 45 address, let's go ahead and go back to our packets. So I know this post coming in is a part of that attack. The attacker is hoping that we will execute that shell script and basically start a C2 channel back to that 62 address that we saw in VirusTotal. So remote code execution, that would allow an attacker to then take control of this box and basically do whatever he wants. So one thing that I could do if I'm interested in taking a look at an attack pattern for the Log4j vulnerability is I can come up here and I can just save this as a filter. And in fact, I'm gonna do that. I'm just gonna switch over from this profile to my security profile, and I'm gonna keep that filter in there, and I'm gonna come over here to plus, and what I do is I have for my label, I'm just gonna say signatures. And I'm just gonna say log4j. So if I ever have packets that match that filter, then I know that that's part of that attack. The next thing that I wanna find out is, did this server react? Did it actually go try to do that C2 callback to that server in the 62 range? Well, let's find out. I'm gonna go ahead and flip from this profile back to my TCP plane profile. And here I'm gonna go ahead and leave that filter there, and I'm gonna add one more to it. First, I'm gonna put parentheses around that filter. So I wanna leave any packets that have that value in there. And then I'm gonna say or, and then what I wanna do is find out, does this server at 198.71, so my server that I have, does that then go do a TCP SYN to any other server out there? Do I see it actually do that C2 callback somewhere? Or is it patched and is it behaving as it should? Is it not reacting to that shell script? Well, let's find out. So I'm gonna go ahead and say or, and I'm gonna say tcp.flags equals equals 0.002. What this is this sets a filter for any TCP SYNs. This wouldn't be for TCP SYNACS, this would be just the TCP SYNs. And then I'm gonna say, and I wanna see ip.src equals equals, so the source of those TCP SYNs would be 198.71.247.91. And I'm gonna go ahead and close bracket, and so I'm gonna go ahead and say enter to apply it. So here what I can see is I still have those original packets with the J and DI string in there. So I still see those original packets, but I don't see any packets that met the secondary part of my filter. I don't see this server then go out and say, oh great, let's go ahead and start a TCP SYN off to this server. Hey, go ahead and take control of me. Thankfully, it's not doing that. Now just to test to make sure I got that filter correct, what I am gonna do is just change the direction here from source to DST, destination. This would make sure that this filter does show us something. I just flip the direction. Show me where that server is the destination for a TCP SYN. And here we get quite a few packets coming in from all over the world. So we already saw that on our GeoIP map. But I'm just going to turn this back around, SRC. So this might be another filter that I want to save. Does this server ever react? Does it act as a client and go out and initiate that connection outbound as a part of that Log4j vulnerability? So there's more interesting stuff going on in this PCAP, but just to keep it simple for you, this is how this attack looks at the packet level. Also, you saw some filters that you can set and save in Wireshark. And also, you got to take a look at that attack from a global perspective and see all of those sins coming in. So I'm still going to try to get my hands on a truly compromised system to see how that system then reacts to that shell script. But for now, this gives us an idea of how that attack actually works. Thanks for stopping by, everybody. I'll see you again.